Downward for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. On that third, oh precious fountain that saved from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
All right, good singing. Good to see everybody here tonight. And glad you made it out to the service. Looking forward to a good service here together this evening. Appreciate you making the effort and being here tonight. Let's open with prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for this evening. Thank you for another opportunity for us to gather together here. Lord, we're thankful for the church family you've given to us, and thank you for their faithfulness to thee, to be in church on Wednesday evening. And Lord, we bow here at the beginning of the service, and we ask that you would meet with us here. You promised that when we gather together here, you'd be in the midst, and we expect your presence here tonight, God, and the best we know how, we yield to you, and we pray that you would speak to our hearts tonight. You know what we need, and I pray that you would give us what we need this evening. Bless the fellowship together, the music, and Lord, the prayer time and the study of your word. May you receive the glory from the service this evening. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
149 together, 149, because he lives. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. 149 on that first together. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth a living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, life is worth a living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death wakes to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth a living just because he lives.
Okay, tonight's letters from the Callahans, missionaries to the U.S. military in Japan. It's 2015, and Catherine and I are back in Japan. We arrived back on the 29th of December, and we as a family celebrated Christmas Eve on New Year's Eve, and Christmas Day on New Year's Day. It worked out very well because it snowed New Year's Day, so we had a white Christmas. It is fun once again to hear Mary Kurasumasu and Akmashaiti Omedetun. And I'm sure that's nowhere even near how you say that. But it's supposed to be Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. As we enter the base and while we are going about our business in town, we thank you all. We thank all of you who have been so faithful over the past year and the new partners we have in the ministry. We started the year off in one direction, as you know. God turned us completely around and gave us a new direction. The verse 1 Corinthians 3:9, "For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, ye are God's building," has always meant a lot to me. Not only does the verse tell us that we are not alone in our lives, but also that God wants to take every step alongside us as we journey throughout this life. Catherine and I drove over 13,000 miles, flew over 16,000 miles, and traveled through 20 states. And through it all, God was with us. On December 4th, I once again had the opportunity to preach at the prison in Orient, Ohio. What an incredible experience. My heart was filled with joy as 14 men made a profession of faith. We understand the Bible says in Luke 15:10, "Likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth." After the rejoicing and praising God for what he had done, the sober reality of my ministry came to full light. One of the young men came up to me and started asking about my military service. He lit up as I told him I had spent 20 years as a soldier and was now a missionary in Okinawa, Japan, to the U.S. military stationed there. He told me he had spent 6 years in the Marine Corps and that he had separated from the military just 18 months ago. My heart broke as I listened to his story and how his life had taken a turn for the worse after he got out. Then he asked me the question that was on his heart, "Do you think they would take me back?" He was referring to the Corps, the place where he was part of something great and part of a family. I asked the most important question, "Are you a felon?" He bowed his head and said yes. Nothing else had to be said. We both knew the answer. It reminded me of another incident that happened at home church years before when I was still on active duty. One day while I was working at the church, a drunk man came up and asked for a handout. He smelled bad and I could smell the alcohol in his breath from a few feet away. He looked at me and asked, "Sergeant Callahan, you don't remember me, do you?" Honestly, I had no idea who he was, but he spoke and told me how he had worked for me in Germany and how I had helped pin on his staff sergeant rank. I finally realized I knew him. A hard life and a lot of alcohol had changed him to the point that I couldn't recognize him. He told me after a bad relationship, he had turned to alcohol, which had led to his discharge from the Army. Both men had chosen their path and were now paying the price for it. The difference is one of them chose Christ when offered to him. He may be in prison now, but because of Christ, he has a chance for a better future. He may not be able to connect to his former family, but with the help of Bible Baptist Church and their RU program, he has a chance to connect to a different type of family, one that will love him more and accept him just the way he is. This brings me to my next point. Having talked to him and remembering the story of my former soldier makes me even more anxious to get to Okinawa, where stories like this can be avoided, where Marines, soldiers, airmen, sailors, Japanese, and every other nationality we come across can be given the only real choice we have in this world, to accept Christ or not. Please pray for us with moving to Okinawa as soon as possible. Your missionary, the Callians.
That's good. All right, get your prayer guide out if you would. Anybody need one tonight? Everybody just put your hand up and he'll get you real quick. Everybody covered? Very good. All right, we'll start with our coming events, and we pray for the RU Inside tomorrow night at the CRC prison. And I appreciate you praying for that ministry Friday night for the Reformers Unanimous here at Bible Baptist Church. And then, of course, Saturday morning, 10 a.m. for our bus visitation and soul winning. And we appreciate you praying for that and be here for that. And let's go out. And it's going to be another warm Saturday, I think. So we'll get another opportunity to have a good day visiting. On the 30th, that's a week from Friday, we leave on the trip to India. Everything is in order, and got the visa yesterday. And 10 days to spare, that's plenty, isn't it? And we're ready to go on that, excited about that opportunity. And looking ahead to February, of course, we start out I Love My Church Month with I Love My Bible Sunday on February 1st. Now, remember, the sign-up sheet's down there for you to sign up for testimonies. And it's just a short testimony on why you love your church. And we'll be doing that each service, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night through the month of February. All right? And so you can sign up. And you can be part of the volunteer program, or you'll be in the draft later. We just have to see what you prefer, all right? Now, we look inside on the praise reports. We praise the Lord for the 40 that were at the prison last week and 23 that received Christ. And thank you for the first-time visitors we had Sunday. Wade Moody continues to improve in the hospital, and continue just rejoice and praise the Lord. Still has a long way to go, but he's doing well. You can add this praise report. I think our Sunday school class prayed for Sarah is when you mentioned that. And this is, of course, Cindy's daughter, Sarah, and saw the OB specialist today, went through extensive testing. No abnormalities with the baby or the pregnancy. So all is well. Praise God for that, and rejoicing with that. And I see she put on Facebook, it's a boy. Yeah, all right. So another boy coming to the Dunn's household. And continue to pray for Sarah and that pregnancy, all right? Praise the Lord for the different church requests and the ministries. We pray that you'll keep those in prayer, and the Lord will use those. And then underneath our health, pray for these on the health list, and lift them up to the Lord in prayer if you would. And on the other side, on cancer, would you add a name to that list? It's Jazz. It looks like... How do you say that? Jasmine. Okay, that isn't what's here. All right. Jasmine Butts, B-U-T-T-S. Most of you know Brandy. Brandy has come before here. Mary Lou's come with Mary Lou. This is Brandy's sister, Jasmine. She's 26 years of age. She has colon cancer. Has been told she has 6 weeks to live. And so let's list Jasmine. Up in prayer this evening, ask God to do a special miracle for her. Okay, do you know Mary Lou? Do you know her spiritual condition? Is she saved, lost? Do you know? Okay. Is that right? Okay. Okay. Yeah, get us some information on that, and because if we can go visit her, we will. All right. Okay. All right. And so add her to the cancer list. Continue to pray for these on the salvation list and these who need to receive Christ as their Savior. And our military, we're thankful for them and their protection, and pray for their safety. And then, of course, our missionaries highlighted tonight by the Callahans in Japan. All right. We're going to go to prayer this evening. Brother Polabel, would you make your way up here to the front? I'm going to have Brother John lead us in prayer this evening. And as he leads us audibly, we want to pray along with him silently for these requests. And again, that's how you unite your hearts together in prayer. All right. So let's join together in prayer at this time. Brother John will lead us.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you for the way you brought us to the church tonight. And we ask that you'd be with each one of us, that we'd open up our ears and listen to the preacher that's and the message that's preached here tonight. We thank you for the good health, and we pray that you'd continue to watch over those that are on our sick list. And then we pray for this young lady that's got cancer and got 26 days to live. We just pray that you would send someone to her door, and that she'd be able to listen with her ears and believe with her heart, and that she'd get this thing, most important thing, settled before she goes into eternity. And that's knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And we pray that you'd be with her now and her family. And we ask that you'd be with the many others that have cancer, and we don't know their conditions. And we just pray that you'd be with them and help them, strengthen them, and give them that they need to make it through each day. And we do thank you for this church that you've raised up here. And we pray that you'd be with the pastor and all those that have a job here at the church to do, and preaching and teaching the boys and girls, the nursery, patch club, and bus route, and all those things that go on throughout the week. Are you at the prison on tomorrow night, and then Friday night? Are you here at the church? And we ask that you would bless these ministries, and we thank you for those that we've learned about that have made provisions and are working in the books. We just pray that you'd give them the understanding and that they need to be able to be a good witness wherever they go and wherever they're at. And we pray that you'd be with them. We also pray that you'd be with Pastor as he makes this trip where he's going, and then that you'd bring him back to us safely. And in your time, we ask that you'd be with all of us here, that we'd be doing what we need to be doing here to carry on the work here. And we ask that you'd be with those that are here tonight that have loved ones at home, and that they would help them to be a comfort that they need as their loved ones are at home and they're here. And we pray that you'd help them now and give them the rest and that they need as they're home sick and everything. We ask that you'd help us. We do pray for those that are on our salvation list. We just pray that each one of us would go over this each day and pray for those that are there, and ask God to bring him to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and be able to bring him in here to church and teach him and preach him the word of God, and have him to be a Christian that would be glorifying to God. We ask that you'd be with the remainder of service, the offering also. We pray that you'd be with the offering that would be able to take care of our needs here at this church. And we pray that you'd be with us as each one of us be a cheerful giver and give that you want us to give. And we pray now that you'd be with their song service and the remainder of the service, and that we bless this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, would you turn with me to hymn number 538, 538. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's stand together as you find that 538 together. Let's sing that first. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die, that he might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last together. Thank you. Redeemer, Savior, friend of men, once ruined by the fall, thou hast devised salvation's plan, for thou hast died for all. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. On that last together, his name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, his reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
All right, be seated if you will. Ushers will come and we'll get our offering tonight. Give us a... Give us the Lord has blessed and prospered you. And let's pray for our offering this evening. Father, we thank you for the privilege that's ours to give. Lord, thank you for how you give to us and you take care of us and provide for our needs. And Lord, I pray that we'd be faithful to give back to you what rightfully belongs to you. But even above that, Lord, we'd be generous and cheerful in our giving to thee, knowing that you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think. Take this offering tonight. Use it to meet the needs of your work in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Take your Bibles this evening to Revelation 17, if you would please. Now, we get into Revelation 17 talking about religious Babylon, or if you will, ecclesiastical Babylon. I probably should give a little preface that I know I'll probably make some enemies this evening. Not intentionally, but I'm good at making them even if I don't mean to. But this is, I think you're going to see as we go through Revelation 17, what is going to be identified here is the one world church that the Antichrist, by the way, will go along with for a period of time. I think he'll go along with it, and you'll see a little later on, until about midway through the tribulation period. And at that point, he's going to commit the abomination of desolation, because listen, he's not about, the Antichrist is not about, which is Satan himself, really. He's not about any religion. He's not about anything that has a form of godliness. He wants to be worshipped. He's the one who wants to get the adoration, praise. He wants the throne of God. That's what he wants, according to Isaiah 28, I think it is, in Ezekiel 14, or the other way around, Isaiah 14, Ezekiel 28. And he wants to be like the Most High. And so at that point, he will turn against the church. And I say church, it's kind of a misnomer. They're not really a church. We'll see that in just a few minutes. But what's called the church during that time, and he will destroy it, and it'll be the destruction of what we would know as the false church. Well, let's look at chapter 17, and then we'll just kind of take it verse by verse and give some explanation and see if we won't uncover some things that'll be enlightening to us tonight, all right? Revelation 17, verse 1. There came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show thee unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they beheld the beast that was and is not and yet is. And here is the mind which hath wisdom, the 7 heads or 7 mountains on which the woman sitteth. And there are 7 kings, 5 are fallen, and 1 is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the 8th and is of the 7, and goeth into perdition. And the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have 1 mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. And they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. And he said unto me, The waters which thou sawest where the whore sitteth are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. And the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore and shall make her desolate and naked and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will and to agree and give their kingdom unto the beast until the words of God shall be fulfilled. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture tonight. And Lord, as we unfold the truths that you put here in Revelation chapter 17, Lord, give us understanding, give us clarity of mind and heart, give us the spiritual discernment we need to understand what you're speaking of, and Lord, to see the beginnings of this even in the day in which we live. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to glean some things here and be aware of some things that will make us better servants for you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, you need to know that chronologically, you would go from chapter 16 right to chapter 19. But in between 17 and 18, John is told to by the angel with the 7th vial to turn aside and look at something. And he's going to show John the destruction of religious and commercial Babylon, as it's called. And let's look at verse number 1. And the first thing you notice is this word whore, which most of us understand is a harlot, is a prostitute, one who
sells her purity for gain, for selfish gain. A wife who is unfaithful to her husband is called an adulteress. A man who is unfaithful to his wife is called an adulterer. But now, with your finger there, I want you to look over to James chapter 4. Would you look in James chapter 4? Just go back to your left, go through the Johns, go through 1 Peter, and then you'll hit James. And look at James 4. James 4, and notice verse number 4. Notice what James writes. Ye, what's the word, church? Adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. So God says, now, you can commit spiritual adultery. How can you do that? By wanting to court a friendship with the world. Wanting to have an alliance with the world. And God says when you do that, you commit spiritual adultery. And so we find out this church, this system, religious system, I guess, that's going to be alive during this time in the tribulation period. You understand, the church is people. I want to teach you something now. I don't believe there is a universal church at this time. Okay? I believe most of the references in the Bible, when it talks about the church, it's talking about local churches, local bodies of believers. The definition of a church is a called out assembly. That's why in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, it talks about the children of Israel, where it was the church in the wilderness. Well, they weren't have pastors and deacons or anything like that, but they were a called out assembly. All right? We're a called out assembly. We're called out from the world and we are assembled together. It's a local church. Now, the church that the Lord will, one day, all of the believers at the rapture of the church, we are going to be called out. We're not only called out, we're going to be called up. And then we'll be the church of the firstborn assembled in heaven, Hebrews tells us. Now there will be the universal church, because we all will be called out and called up. Now, when that happens, you understand, believers will go up no matter what church they're in. Okay? The key to going to heaven isn't what church you're going to. The key is, do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? Have you been born again? And you're going to find out as we get into this apostate church and you find out what it is. It doesn't mean that everybody in that church is lost. It means there are some, I believe there's people in the Mormon church that are saved. Yep. Not by Mormon doctrine, amen, but saved before they ever got caught up into it. And so many of them, they used to talk about in Mormonism how thankful they were for Baptist churches, because that's where they got most of their converts, was from the Baptists. Because we're the aggressive ones going out and preaching the gospel and getting folks to make a profession of faith and receive Christ, and then here they come. And they suck them into their system. And into their group. Now, if they're truly saved, they're going to go when the Lord comes back. And there's folks in other denominations and other places. Now, I think if you're going to go to heaven, you might as well fly first class and be an independent Baptist. But it doesn't mean you're not going to get there. All right. And so I want you to make sure that that's clear. So church here, and I keep saying that word, but I think if you're not a called out assembly, in other words, if you're not called out from the world, if you're courting the friendship with the world, I think you lose your right to call yourself a church. I do. I think you're not true to the name, and that's why we don't invite the world into the church. At least we're not supposed to. That's why we don't go to the world and say, what would you like to have in church? We'll have that so you can come. Well, then all we did was bring the world into the... We brought the water into the boat, and the boat's going to sink. And worse than that, God says it's spiritual adultery. And we will have Ichabod written over the church. So there's two important lessons you learn about this false church that there is. And that, number one, they'll teach salvation by works. And you'll see that as with this chapter unfolds. They'll teach salvation by works. In other words, you're going to have to do something in order to go to heaven. The second lesson you're going to learn is they're going to charge for their spiritual services. they're going to charge their whore. Okay? Not my word now. That's God's word. Okay? Don't say you shouldn't use that word. God used that word. And he's letting us know they're doing it for their own gain. We'll say more about that in just a little bit. Now, when it says it sitteth upon many waters, look down at verse number 15. Verse 15 explains that. By the way, oftentimes you'll find that the best commentary on the Bible is the Bible. And oftentimes what you need to do if you don't understand a verse is keep reading. Oftentimes you'll come to the verse that will explain what that verse was all about. Okay? Verse 15, notice what it says. He says unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. So those waters represent people. They represent nations. They and what you're going to find out is the church at this time that this religious system will envelop the entire world. Okay? It's going to be the one world church. Okay? And it's going to sit on the many waters. Now, look at verse number 2. It says, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. It simply is reminding us it's a state religion. It's been a union of the state and the church. It's an unholy alliance between the church and the state. And by the way, they're going to gladly, the state's going to be in control, the Antichrist and the false prophet, they're going to link together and it's going to be the state-run church. And we're seeing the early beginnings of that, especially even in our country. We're starting to see that take place. Notice verse number 3. So he carried me away in the spirit in the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of the names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. That scarlet beast is the Antichrist. You find that later on in the passage as well. The woman is identified in verse number 18. The verse number 18 says, the woman which thou sawest is that great city. So we know the woman is a city. All right? And we find out that city, you're going to find out in just a little bit, that city is Rome. Okay? And you'll see that in just a little bit. And which at time will have inherited all the different religions of the world and bring them under one umbrella. Now the 7 heads and the 10 horns that it mentions, having 7 heads and 10 horns, that's the revived Roman Empire. I think I gave you a little map tonight so you can see what the Roman Empire looked like and then what the revived Roman Empire looked like and how many of these revived Roman Empire are Muslim countries. It's really a fascinating thing. All right. Now, notice verse number 4. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. It speaks of the wealth of this false religion. Purple was the color of Roman imperialism. Every senator and knight wore a purple stripe, designating their rank. Emperors wore robes of purple. The scarlet color has been adopted by the Roman Catholic Church. Notice, gilded with gold. Notice it talks about decked with gold. That's an outward display of their wealth. Okay? And the precious stones and the pearls. Again, unashamedly displaying the wealth that they have. You would be amazed at the wealth of the Roman Catholic Church. And the truth is, you try Googling it. I did for several hours. You can't find any accurate number. Nobody wants to admit it. Nobody wants to keep track of it. But I'll share a few things with you. By the way, just so you know. And by the way, notice what the cup she has is filled with: abominations and filthiness of her fornication. What has come to light here in the last 15 years has been the sexual abuse in the Catholic Church. And as of the most recent thing I could find, their payouts settling these cases is approaching 3 billion with a B, $3 billion they've paid out. And they're not done yet. But it hasn't hurt the operation at all. Let me give you a couple of statistics. Notre Dame, which most of us would recognize as the flagship Catholic university in America, they have an annual budget of $1.2 billion. That's one university. They have an endowment that's estimated at $7.5 billion. The Archdiocese of Chicago last year reported cash investments in buildings valued at $2.47 billion. In Rome, the Institute for the Works of Religion, known popularly as the Vatican Bank, administers assets in excess of $6 billion. They say that American Catholics drop more than $8 billion every year into the Sunday collection plate. In Germany, the Catholic Church netted $8.8 billion in 2010 just from a national church tax, allowing it to remain the country's largest private employer after Volkswagen. Hospitals. By the way, let me tell you this. The Catholic Church has 5,000, this is worldwide, 5,399 elementary schools, 1,195 secondary schools, 1,861 Catholic colleges and universities. They have 5,167 hospitals. In one Catholic system in the hospital, Ascension Health, the country's largest, with 1,400 locations in 21 states and the District of Columbia, had revenues of $15 billion in 2011. The wealth is just incredible. I've never been to the Vatican. Has anybody been to the Vatican? Dean, you've been over there? A lot of statue, a lot of gold, a lot of wealth. Am I right? I've seen pictures, of course, you know, by television and such, but I've never been there in person. Untold wealth, and they don't mind flaunting it. Catholic Charities, here's your union of church and state. Catholic Charities of the U.S., one of the largest private charitable networks in the United States, had revenues in 2010 of $4.67 billion. Of which $2.9 billion of it came from our government. The U.S. government gave the Catholic Charities $2.9 billion. I didn't hear anything about separation of church and state there, did you? Nothing at all. So it's you can go on and on. It's just, and see, it all stays, by the way, that two-some billion in Chicago, that stays there. None of the churches send it to the Vatican. Everybody keeps it local, and they keep their money. And in fact, the articles I've been reading says the Vatican doesn't know what the Archbishop or the Archdiocese of Chicago what they spend on things. They don't have any no accounting up that goes up to them. So they all are making their own money, and it's an incredible amount of wealth. And I'm reminded that of the scripture, remember the church of Laodicea, that said, I am rich and increased with goods, and I have need of nothing. And what did God say? You know not that you're poor and you're wretched and you're naked and you're blind. You're miserable. And he's true. False religion is an abomination in the sight of God. And this religious organization of the end time, this one world church, as it will be called, is an abomination in the sight of God. Now, let's look at her name, verse number 5. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Babylon the Great, Babylon. Where do you think that started from? Tower of Babel in Genesis 11. Remember, the whole thing there in Genesis 11, it started with a man named Nimrod. If you ever want to understand these two Babylons and how they connect, there's a book was written years ago called The Two Babylons. And if you never read that, you ought to read that book. But Nimrod, the Bible says, was a mighty hunter before the Lord. In other words, it wasn't doing it in the presence of God. He wanted to be before God. When he instituted, what he got going was, let's all build a tower. And that it may reach where? Reach into heaven. Is that the way God said you're going to get to heaven? No. I think it was twofold. I think he wanted to have his own way to get to heaven. And I think he wanted to have something they could climb up into in case there's another big flood like they just had. Something to be tall enough that they'd be able to be safe. And they all got together to try to do that. And rather than, because listen, the alternative is to walk in obedience to God. Well, that's not an option. He didn't want that. And so he started his own religion. The Bible says, remember, they used brick for stone and slime for mortar. Those are poor imitations of the real thing. Okay? And that's exactly what false religion does. Gives you bad imitations of the real thing. And the church still does that. And so that's where the mother of idolatry came in. They had a virgin, and she had a son, and it parallels what God did in sending his son. And this is where they get the woman, and this is where the Catholic Church gets the idea that Mary's the Queen of Heaven. It started way back with the Tower of Babel and Nimrod and Babylon and what that religion did, and it traveled all the way through the Canaanites and into the Babylonian Empire in Daniel's day, and then on into the Roman Catholic Church. Babel, by the way, originally they called it B-A-B-E-L. Now, you know, Bethel, El, means God. All right? B-E-T-H, Bethel was house of. So Bethel meant house of God. That's what Jacob. They come to Babel. They wanted to call it the gate of God. That's what that meant. The gate of God. But God came down and said, this isn't going to happen. And by the way, what was Nimrod doing? Bringing everybody together. If you recall, after the flood, when they had Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and God separated them, didn't he? You're going over here. You're going over here. You're going over here. Nimrod came along and said, let's just all come together. And when God saw that, you know what God did? He came down, and what did he do? He confounded their language and said, get back where I put you. And he scattered them out again. And he confounded their language. He called it Babel, which means confusion. And listen, what has brought more confusion to the world than man-made religion? Than religions that think you can build your own way to God. And you can get your own way of being accepted by God. So let me give you four lessons from the Tower of Babel just quickly. Number one, it represented a man-made religion. It represented a man-made religion. Number two, it's made of a false unity. Number three, it had an earthly city as its center. And number four, they had an earthly representative from heaven. Or in other words, one man over it all. In their case, it was Nimrod. And by the way, that's why it says that they... The abominations, let's see, full of names of blasphemy in verse number 3. They call the Pope the potentate. Am I right? Those of you who are Catholic? It means the powerful one or the all-powerful one. There's only one potentate. And he sits on the throne in heaven, not on the throne in the Vatican. So the names that they give to him, they're blasphemous. Why? Because they belong only to God. And he's the only one who deserves those names. And so that's why it's called the names of blasphemy. Now, it says Babylon the Great. Now, notice what else it says. Now, sit tight. The mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. He calls this false church now, the mother of harlots. And did you know that the Roman Catholic Church is the mother of most of your denominations? That's why they're called Protestant denominations. Now, I want you to understand something. Baptists are not Protestants. It is what you had. You had a fellow named Martin Luther. Have you ever heard of Martin Luther? All right, Martin Luther was a Catholic monk, and he was reading his Bible, which was kind of a no-no, but he was doing it anyway. And he was reading the Bible and found the just shall live by faith. And he was thinking on this and dwelling on this while he's crawling on his knees up the stairs, trying to get his sins absolved. And finally he said, what am I doing this for? The just shall live by faith. Well, he got up off his knees and he went and posted his 95 theses that he had on the door of the bishop there. And he ended up, of course, getting excommunicated from the church. And they tried to, and he started the group, of course, that eventually would be Lutherans. But from there came the Methodists, and from there came the Episcopalian, and from there came Anglicans, and from there came all the denominations that are called Protestant denominations, because they came out of the Catholic Church protesting the way of salvation, that it's not by works, it's by faith in Christ. All right? And you say, well, that's good, but you have to remember something. When they came out of the Catholic Church, though they were right on salvation, they carried a lot of other stuff out with them that wasn't right. They still believed in baptizing babies. They believed in infant baptism. Baptism is for believers. It is believers' baptism. And by the way, Baptists have always believed that. All this time, when there was a Roman Catholic Church and these guys came protesting out, they were always the Baptists. They always there. You can trace, I think you can trace Baptists all the way back to John the Baptist. Amen. God named him that. Yep. What did his parents name him? John. Who called him John the Baptist? Yeah, God did. That's who named him that. Because he baptized people by immersion. All right? It's always been that way. So we didn't come out of the Catholic Church. So you go to the hospital and they say, are you Catholic or Protestant? You say, neither. Neither. I'm Baptist. Amen. See? You're not a Protestant. I never came out of the Catholic Church protesting anything. And by the way, we don't bring the baggage with us from the Catholic Church. And that's why the sprinkling of babies, statues in the churches, rituals, liturgies, burning candles. I grew up in Baptist churches. I grew up in independent, Bible-believing Baptist churches. And I'll never forget, I was early. I would have been only 26 years of age and pastoring my first church. I remember a lady coming to me and saying, what time is our candlelight Christmas Eve service? I looked at her and said, what? I never heard of such a thing. I didn't know that you did anything like that. Well, I found out later, who has candlelight Christmas Eve services? The Catholic Church did. That's where she had been. And she got saved and she came into the church, but what did she want to do? She wanted to bring that luggage with her and say, hey, bring this into our church. So, well, needless to say, she didn't have a candlelight service. And I'm not saying everybody who has one is Catholic. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying what we have to be careful is we carry things in, and we carry the baggage in, and you have to make sure that things you carry in line up with that book right there, that it's scriptural to do that, and they adapt a philosophy of, listen, as is the mother, so is the daughter. That's why how many ever been in a old Lutheran, Presbyterian, Episcopalian, one of those kind of churches. You ever been in one like that? Did it remind you of a Catholic service? Sure, because that's their mom. And children do take on a likeness of their parents. You know, you can't help that. All right? You won't look at those two linky boys and say, I wonder who they belong to. Huh? You know that right away, don't you? Huh? You just understand that. And so they adopt the practices and the theology of mother. And by the way, they're now coming full circle and they're coming back to mama. Now, the Catholic Church has run campaigns about come home. You ever seen those signs in people's yards? Come home. That's what that's all about. And I'll say more about that in just a minute, about how they're going to get everybody to come back home to mama. And they're going to get some who weren't even from the Catholic Church going to unite with them as well. And I'll shoot down some of your favorites when I get to that point. But the non-denominational, listen, non-denominational churches are part of that same thing. What are they? Whatever you want. You want to be immersed? Okay, we'll immerse you. You want to be sprinkled? Okay, we'll sprinkle you. You don't want to believe that? Okay, don't believe that. Okay, you want to do this? Okay, do that. And we just let you do whatever you want to do. You want ritual? We'll give you ritual. We'll give you whatever you want. And eventually they'll return to mama. And the Bible says they will. And it'll come back together. False religion, verse number 6. Here's another thing, and this I'll give you some things to read. I saw the woman drunken. What is she drunken with? Blood of the saints, and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration, drunk with the blood. In other words, this religion is guilty of murder. Murder of who? God's people. Read, if you've never read Fox's Book of Martyrs, you need to read Fox's Book of Martyrs. The Roman Catholics would, that's what the Inquisitions were all about. They were looking for Christians who were reading the Bible, which they forbid people to do. And you would be killed. They killed by the millions. Millions. You read Fox's Book of Martyrs, you'll understand that. Read about the Spanish Inquisitions and read about, you can see where they're drunk with the blood of the saints. And by the way, let me make sure we understand this too. Yeah. Martin Luther hated Baptists. John Calvin hated Baptists and killed Baptists. Again, because they came out of the Catholic Church, and while they believed in salvation by grace through faith, they still wanted to baptize you as an infant. And if you didn't submit to being baptized as an infant, if you didn't let your children do that, he had you killed. And where it grieves me at times how sometimes in our churches today, we quote Luther and we quote Calvin and we quote, and if they were alive today and had a chance to take you out, they would. Read history. Read up on those men. They're not our friends. And they had that baggage from the Roman Catholic Church. All right? Now, there's, so it's a matter of the umbrella that everyone's going to come under will be the Roman Catholic Church. How do you know that for sure? Look at the next verse. In fact, look at verse 9. Would you look there? And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. Is there any city that's called the city that sits on seven hills? Yeah, that's Rome. It's the city that sits on seven hills. And that, by the way, the Roman Catholic Church, in its confraternity edition of the New Testament, 1963, makes this statement, Rome is Babylon. States it in their own literature. Rome is Babylon. They make no bones about it. Now, they're going to bring everybody together under one worldwide church. Now, here's the thing. Let me show you how this is starting to get together. I mentioned several weeks ago that Rick Warren, who is from the Saddleback Church out in California, he wrote the book, The Purpose-Driven Life, 40 Days of Purpose, and I mean thousands of churches worldwide have used this and use his material. He is saying that the Pope is the father of us all. He's the leader of all believers. Well, he's not the leader of this believer. Well, there's only one head of the church, and according to the book of Ephesians, that's Jesus Christ. He's the head of the church, no one else. Listen carefully. Now, in May 2014, in an article written by James Robinson on a website entitled Pope Francis on Life Today, Robeson said this: I believe in the importance of unity among those who know Christ, who profess to be, quote, Christians. I believe that there is an important spiritual awakening beginning in the hearts of those truly committed to Christ in the Protestant and Catholic communities. Is it possible that Pope Francis may prove to be an answer not only to the prayers of Catholics, but also those known as Protestants? In the article, Robinson goes on to make a reference to the recently deceased Anglican recruiter for the Catholic Church, Tony Palmer. Robinson stated of his, the Pope's, very best friend, one of his best friends, Bishop Tony Palmer, whom we have supported in mission outreaches for years, shares the message that Pope Francis asked him to deliver to evangelical and Protestant believers. Says that John Lanigan, who wrote another book, Lighthouse Trails, he said, stated that Tony Palmer claims he's been consecrated by Pope Francis to be a bridge for further unity among Protestants and Catholics. He said the Protestants who disagree are suffering from spiritual racism. Just wait. He's not done yet. The Beth Moore, some of you have heard of her, she spoke at Robertson's Awake Now conference in February of 2014, not even a year ago. She again expressed her belief that God showed her that a great spiritual awakening was coming. Interestingly, she warned the audience of 4,000 people about those who would question this great awakening and, quote, downpour. We must be prepared in advance for scoffers. I'll say that again. We must be prepared in advance for scoffers. And here's the thing. The world scoffing is not going to bother us much. We're used to them thinking we're idiots. We're used to it. Of course, they think that. We've got that one down. That's not going to bother us so much. What's going to bother us, and I believe God is saying, get prepared for it so you know in advance it's coming. So when it does happen, you're not all disturbed and all rocked by it, because it's going to come from some in our own Christian realm, our own brothers and sisters. We're going to have people that are honestly going to want to debate and argue with us about awakening and downpours. What do you want here? They're going to say, that's not the way it should look. You know what, dude? I'm just asking you, are you thirsty? Are you hungry? I can't think of the way to the semantics to get it like you want it. But I will say to you, I'm just thirsty and hungry. There'll be scoffers, there'll be far bigger threat. The one from within our own brothers and sisters, our own family of God, far, far more demoralizing. And yes, it will come from the bullies. Yes, it will come from the mean-spirited. So you understand, whether it's Rick Warren or Beth Moore or James Robertson, what they're doing is they're trying to say, let's all just get together. And when you say, no, we're not getting together, well, you're mean-spirited. You're a racist. You're a hater. And so, listen, I can... This is not in the Bible. This is me. I think when the rapture takes place and we're gone, I think they'll believe a lie and say the haters are gone. Those who didn't want all this to come together, God has taken them out of the way. Now we can all have the downpour. We can all have the outpouring. Here it is. And we'll all get together. And by the way, that's got to include Islam as well. That's that you're gonna see the Catholic Church reaching out to Islam to unite the two together. You're gonna see that take place. You mark my word, because you can't have the revived Roman Empire without it, and you're not gonna have a one world church without it. And they're going to do that. And now I got everybody angry with me, so let's keep going. Verse 10. And there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Five kings, seven kings altogether. The kings so far had been Julius Caesar, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius, Nero. One is, that was Domitian, the time that John penned these words in Revelation. One will be, that's the Antichrist. All right? And he'll be head of the revived Roman Empire. Ten horns in verse 12. Again, the ten horns are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as of yet, but they receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. They'll make up the revised Roman Empire, but they just are united under the beast. They just do whatever he wants them to do. What are they going to do? Verse 14, they're going to make war with the Lamb. They're going to make war with the Lamb. But notice the Lamb shall what? Overcome them. All right, the Lamb. Hey, they'll make war with the Lamb, but they'll be defeated. We're on the winning side, okay? We're on the winning side. So remember that. And we are, we are with Christ when he comes the second time. When he comes, and you'll read about, we'll study that in Revelation 19. When he returns to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords and set up his kingdom on earth, we're coming back with him. And we're going to be the victorious army that'll set up his rule upon this earth. All right. Verse 16. And the ten horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore. Here's the turning now. They'll hate the whore and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. They're going to turn and destroy the false church. They're going to think that everything's great, and what a great union, what a great outpouring, what a great downpour this is, and how wonderful all of us are together. And boy, the Antichrist is going to turn on them. And the nations are going to turn on them. And they're going to destroy them. That'll happen, as I said, about halfway through the tribulation, when he's going to set himself up as God. And he's going to make that image and say, everybody bow down to the beast and worship the beast. Okay? And then it's going to be too late. All right? And by the way, he reminds us here in verse 17, that all that they're doing is fulfilling the plan of God. Everything's in his control. Notice, God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree and to give their kingdom unto the beast until the words of God shall be fulfilled. Hey, why? How am I going to get Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem? Oh, I'm going to put it in the heart of Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed, so everybody has to return to his own city. See? God, the Most High rules in the kingdom of men, and he sets up over it whomsoever he will. And God, the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord, and as rivers of water, he turns it whithersoever he will. And so you see, all these things are happening. Somebody, I saw a clip that somebody had sent, and it was a pact that was made recently between Iran and Russia. Showed Putin and Ahmadinejad sitting at a table, and they signed the agreement. We didn't make any news broadcasts in America. All I had to get it from over there. But you know what that is? That's Persia and Gog and Magog making their pact, and that they're going to be together. You don't need a nuclear Iran. You got a nuclear Russia. They don't need to have nuclear. Iran doesn't need it. They just need to have a partner. And now they have one. It's all beginning. But you know what? That's all according to God's plan. It's all according to his will. Notice it says, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. There's not a jot or a tittle that will fail of what God says is going to happen. And so, listen, let's make sure. Hey, you want to make sure, if you're sure of anything, you want to make sure you're saved. You want to make sure you think, well, if I'm not, I'll be sure and get saved. Don't be so sure about that. God will send them strong delusion that you can believe a lie. And you don't know how easy it can be deceived. Hey, I've got enough trouble, I might as well say this too. I did not watch the State of the Union last night. I listened to it. And as I listened to the speech and the outright lies and the people who just swallowed it up, I can see how the world would accept an Antichrist. I can see how the world would accept a leader that has good talking and tells them what they want to hear, because we're all about what we want to hear. Hey, America hasn't, the crisis isn't over. We haven't turned any corner when we're going into debt. Listen to me now, $1 million a minute. We are going in the hole $1 million every minute, every day. We are now $18 trillion in debt. That cannot last. And it won't last. And to ignore it and just say, hey, everything's great. The economy's pumping. People are hiring. Things are moving. We've turned the corner. No, you haven't. And to do so is just denial. And doesn't matter who says it, it's not true. And you can't sustain that. And then to say, hey, let's pay for this and let's give everybody 2 years of college and let's pay for this and let's pay for that. Where does that come from? But everybody eats it up. And I think, wow, what has happened to our country? Same thing that's happening all over the world. It's all in God's control. It's all going to go according to His plan. We just have to be prepared for that. All right? Well, it's not the most uplifting of studies. All right? I understand that. But you ought to know, and you ought to be aware that when somebody says, hey, let's join together with so-and-so and such-and-such and all that, or you hear, you have a lot of groups now that just want to get together because, well, it doesn't matter. They say, it doesn't matter what doctrine you believe, just because you love Jesus. Yeah. Oh, no. You don't fellowship on love of Jesus. You fellowship on your doctrine. Amen. Doctrine is what unites us. Our doctrine divides us. And you have to agree on the doctrine. And that's vital. And so, and you'll be called mean-spirited. You'll be called narrow. You'll be called racist. You'll be called all kinds of troublemakers, haters, you know. You'll be all kinds of things. And you just have to, but you want to be true to what God's Word says. I want nothing to do with an ecumenical church. I don't even do with it. That's part of the false church, and that ain't going to happen. I want to be part of His church. Amen. And it's going to be gathered up, called up and gathered together. Church of the firstborn assembled in heaven. Amen. Let's stand together and we'll have a word of prayer. Everybody standing, heads bowed and eyes closed. We're going to have just a short invitation this evening. The Lord has spoken to your heart and you want to use the altar this evening. I want to give you an opportunity to do that. Just whatever God has spoken to your heart about or laid on your heart, you want to spend some time to pray, just take a moment and do that. Father, we pray your blessing on this brief invitation tonight. Pray your will would be done in each one of our hearts and lives. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, as the piano plays, Brother Bob may sing, you may not, but if she's going to play, if God has spoken to your heart, you want to use the altar, you come tonight.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. For now indeed I find thy power and thy alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
All right, good, and be seated for a minute, would you please? We're getting the name of the Rivers family up here, and they're coming to join our church this evening. Isn't that great? When did you start coming? She's talking to Amy right now. Do you remember, Mike? Was it 6 months or so ago? All right. And great to have them coming for membership tonight. So she gets the info down there. We'll read it to you and bring them in. You got it? All right. All right. We have Mike, Amy, I think it's Michaela. I got it right, didn't I? Madison, I got that one down. All right. And they're all coming. They all have been saved and scripturally baptized and coming by their statement of faith and would like to unite in membership with our church. And all those in favor of welcoming the Rivers family into our church, let it be known by hearty aye.
Aye.
And opposed by like sign. Okay, there it is. No, nobody said anything. Amen. Good to have you with us. Praise the Lord. That's great. And that's wonderful. Came and said, can we join the church tonight? I said, absolutely. I said, don't always have invitation on Wednesday night, but if somebody wants to join the church, we'll have an invitation. Amen. And that's a blessing. And we're going to have you head to the back when we stand for prayer so folks can leave and welcome you to the church family. And hope we can be a blessing to you. I know you guys will be one to us. All right. Amen. Let's stand together and let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this evening now. Thank you, Lord, for the time to study your word together. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to digest the truths that we've heard this evening. Lord, most of all, help us to keep our eyes focused on thee and pleasing you. And Lord, help us to so live in this world that would give you the glory. And folks would see our God and they'd see our good works and glorify our Father which is in heaven. We love you, Lord. We thank you for each one that's here tonight. Thank you for the Rivers family. Thank you for bringing them our way, Lord. And I pray that you'll help us to be an encouragement and a blessing to them always. And Lord, I pray that you'll show them where they need to serve and what they could be doing for you here. And Lord, help them to roll their sleeves up and get involved serving thee until you come back for us all. Yes. Dismiss us now with your care. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Oh, how I love Jesus. There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. Let's sing it together. There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Sing it now. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. God bless you. You are dismissed.